So this is the last technique. And it's perhaps the most powerful in the sense that we're encapsulating, we're dealing with something in a larger context. So let's imagine we have a design, a car, an engine, spark plug like this. The car uses the engine in the interface. The engine uses the spark plug in the interface the way we have it right now. Now, that's probably not very realistic. This is saying that everybody from the outside sees the car, everybody from the outside sees the engine, everybody from the outside sees the spark plug. Yeah, not really. This is what we call a sphere of encapsulation. The car is its own entity. Each one of these things is its own entity. So it's encapsulating its implementation. Now, suppose I change this slightly and I say that the car has an engine as opposed to uses the engine in its interface, which is more realistic. A car has an engine. Now the car uses the engine in its implementation. And you'll notice now that people who are using the car don't know anything about the engine or the spark plug, even though the spark plug is used in the interface of the engine. No one knows that the car has an engine. Okay? Now imagine we change this to fuel. And imagine that the car uses fuel in the interface. Now, the engine is an detail of the car. Even though the engine exists, when someone's using the car, they don't know about the engine. If I were to take that engine and re-implement the car with another engine, no client would be aware. So if you look at something like this, we have a graph, we have nodes and edges like this, and I could extract out from the node as we did before, the node data and the edge data. And so we'll change this. So you change all the level numbers here. So now I have this nice big thing. So let's look at the spheres of encapsulation. Everybody can see the graph, everybody can see the node and the edge and all of this because it's all in the interface. And oh, by the way, this is another one. So you have the graph, they don't know about the vector, and also they don't know about the vector from the node either. So these are the things that are client facing. Now, suppose I say that the graph will let me get the node data and edge data out, and I convert the node and the edge to imp details. Now, this is what I have. People use the graph, they use the node data and the edge data, and they have no knowledge of any of this. And if I were to re-implement the graph using something else, they couldn't tell from programmatically that I did. They wouldn't have to rework their code, they don't care. So, suppose what I want to do is create a wrapper, a single component wrapper, so that I don't want anybody to see what I've done down here. I want to present that as a facade. So, my graph, my node, my edge, just like that. And now, these are all imp details of this component. And by that I mean, they exist. Somebody could come along and use those, but if they're using this, they would have no way to know that I implemented that with these components. So, it turns out that a multi-component wrapper is problematic. So if I have a date and a date set, the date naturally interacts with the date set. Now if I create my date, and it uses date in the implementation, and I have my date set, and it uses date set in the implementation, and my date set takes a my date. The problem here is that my date set has no way to get at the date so that it can stuff it in the date set. So we have a problem here. And what this is saying is that that operation right there can't happen. There's no way for it to happen. Now, do you understand why what I'm saying is true? The problem is that there's no way to know that this is here from that from that component, from that thing, because this is an imp detail of that. It's used in the implementation. So there's no way for this thing, when it gets hold of one of those, to reach in and grab this and put it here. Does that make sense? Now we can fix that. We can fix that like this by making it a single component wrapper. Now we have friendship. And now this can make this a friend. And as soon as that happens, this can reach in here and grab the date. And it all works. The trouble is, single component wrappers don't scale. That all works. Right? Because if I try to make this bigger, it doesn't scale. Now, one thing people sometimes try to do is hide something that's mutually dependent upon in the interface. And I find this to be really bad taste, if nothing else. Because what you're doing is you're taking something that's potentially reusable and saying the only way that we can maintain our encapsulation, so to speak, is to hide this header file. And that precludes our ability to reuse things later. It involves architecture with deployment, something that I never want to do. I want architecture to be separate. And then later, once we're ready to deploy, and somebody came up to me during the break and asked, can we ever have more than one CPP file for a header file? Yes, we can, but that's a deployment issue. Architecturally, a component has a header file and an implementation. And so that's number one. And number two, it inhibits side-by-side reuse of the hidden component. Because later, suppose I want to use that component with something else, and then I want to use these things all together, but I need that, so that would stop that from being used. So this is a bad idea as well. So now, I'm going to show you something, and it turns out that in the C++ Standards Committee last week, we talked about something called modules. And it'll turn out that modules will probably replace this technique, if they ever come to be, by the way they were being voted upon and such. But let me just show you what we do without modules. So suppose we have a system here, and this is actually trying to be a somewhat realistic system, not just something that I just scribbled together, but actually something that could conceivably be a real thing. And you'd have to look fairly closely at it to see it. But yes, there's inheritance, there's users in the interface. This is actually could be considered something like a factory, but this is a subsystem. Now, sometimes we want to present a view of a subsystem to a client. And as I told you, having a multi-component wrapper doesn't work. So let's do it anyway. The way we're going to do it is we're going to create a clone of this up here. And this is going to be our wrapper package. And we're going to say that each one of these things to start with uses one of those guys in the implementation. And we know this is going to be problematic, and then we're going to work around it in a really ugly way, and then we're going to realize that modules might actually help us. So first thing we're going to do is observe that uses in the implementation in a wrapper doesn't make any sense, because the wrapper package, everything in the wrapper package is at the same level of abstraction. So trust me for a second when I say we're going to take that away, and then looks like that guy's no longer at level 3. We'll put him at level 2 and he falls down there. Then inheritance is another thing that doesn't exist in the wrapper level, because all of that is going on in the lower level. So we'll get rid of that, and then those guys, turns out they have no purpose, so they go away. And then this guy, I just decided I don't need him. I don't want to show him to the client. Just don't want to do it. So I just get rid of that. And then lastly, this arc here, I don't like it. So I get rid of it. Now, this is the view that I want to present to my client. Everything else is under construction, and I just want to leave that there. This is what my client can use. And the problem is, as we discussed, is that we have this multi-component wrapper. And even though this, let's say, for example, this here is used in the interface of that, there's no way for this thing to get this thing out to stuff into there, at least at the moment. So we have to fix that. So what I'm going to suggest is a strategy, and as I said, this is very much like what modules are going to do, but we don't have them yet. Imagine we have a left and a right, and a left and a right here, and I just dumbed it down to be something very simple. And the left wrapper uses the left system thing, and the right wrapper uses the right system thing. And all it does is hold the imp. That's all it ever does. It always, these guys always hold the corresponding guy down there. So it's exactly that all the time. So if you have one of those guys at the top, you know what it holds. And what we're going to do, it's kind of creepy, but what we're going to do is we're going to just use that global knowledge to be able to take, because this guy is always the data member of this guy, we know that, it's the dirty secret of the wrapper package, we're going to reach inside with a reinterpret cast, and this is legal C++, we're going to take that guy and we're going to turn him into the other guy. We're just going to go, I know you're that guy, so poof, you're that guy. Then it turns into the lower level one. Now it's really creepy, but it works. And now anything in the wrapper package knows that if it's in the wrapper package, it corresponds to something in the lower level package. But it's not like friendship. What it is it's like package level, it's like package level friendship, but it's better because if you exist, then there is a corresponding piece down in the lower level that is exactly what I want to see. But the client doesn't know this. The client would certainly not be allowed to cast this thing to something in the lower level because we never promised that to the client. That would be just totally out of band. But this is the only way I know to allow an entire subsystem to be mirrored with objects and completely kept separate. So, as I said, this is something to think about. This is the implementation then gets stuffed into this sum function and it works in general. It's just a general purpose technique. And as I said, modules may do this for us. So we'll see. But it's something to think about. Now, I did want to point out that packaging is not just a naming convention. When we name packages, we have to name them in a way that respects physical dependencies. So the way this is set up right now, I have the middle row is implementation. These are things that are not client facing. So I want to put them in a separate package. And then the things on the top row and on the bottom row are client facing. So I want to put them in their own package. Now I chose to group these this way because it made logical sense. But it doesn't make physical sense. As you can see, the client facing package depends on the imp and the imp depends on the client facing package. And this is not okay. So we can't do this. Even if we want to, we can't because it's a violation of our physical design rules. So we have to name things differently so there's a consequence to the physical rules. And so we're going to name them sub W, sub M, and sub T. In our world, packages are 4 to 6 characters long. The names are 4 to 6 characters long. And the client-facing packages tend to be shorter, 4. And the non-client facing ones tend to be longer, 5 or 6. Sometimes it's 4 or 5 and 5 or 6. But we might group this slightly differently. We might decide that here are protocols and here are value types. And while we wouldn't generally make packages based on syntactic properties, once in a blue moon we might, but more often we will make our packages based on semantic properties. So here we have a package group, and we'd like to be able to refer to this group of packages by name, but I'm not willing to pay any more characters than I've already spent. And so the way we name our package groups is the first 3 characters is the package group name, and the remaining 1, 2, or 3 separates them into packages. And so this is the sub package group. Now at Bloomberg, we have BSL, BDL open sourced, and then we have a bunch of other package group names. But I wanted to show you that this is a very economical way to keep our package name short so we don't need to use using. Exactly 3 characters. Thoughts? Yes.
So your package groups are distinguished in code with namespaces?
No. Packages have distinct namespaces for logical content, and the file names have the package name as a prefix. Package group is the first 3 characters, and that's the only way we can do it without making it a burden to everybody and still keep everything to be unique throughout the enterprise. Any other questions? All right, well, this is the end of the section. So if you have any questions, now would be a good time. And here is a summary of the different techniques we talked about while I drink a little water. All right. So we are going to change gears now. Insulation. We've talked about link time dependency. We're going to talk about compile time dependency. If you have compile time dependency, you have physical dependencies. If you have link time dependency, you have physical dependencies. But if you have link time dependencies, you don't necessarily have compile time dependencies. So we're going to look at what that means. So, insulation. Encapsulation versus insulation, an implementation detail of a component type, data, or function that can be altered, added, or removed without forcing clients to rework their code is said to be encapsulated. An implementation detail of a component type, data, or function that can be altered, added, or removed without forcing clients to recompile is said to be insulated. Do we see the difference? Okay. So imagine I have this collection of components, and in this case, I've inverted it simply for the graphics. So the highest level component is on the bottom. I never do this, but in this case, I did this so that I could draw this a little bit better. Here's the client. Here's a library component. Here's an imp detail. Suppose I change the header file of the imp detail. What happens? It means that there is a direct short circuit and everything here has to recompile. So the client has to recompile. D is encapsulated by C, or more accurately, the use of D is encapsulated by C, but the client has to recompile. Now let's look at this. Here's an imp detail E. If that changes, it goes to the CPP file of the C component, and that's it. That has to recompile, but the client doesn't have to recompile. Therefore, E is insulated by C, or again, use of E is insulated by C.
It'll have to relink though? The client will have to relink?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
But that's much less painful than
recompiling. Absolutely. Absolutely. If you think about having one enum at the bottom of your system that has all the error codes. Imagine you have something as big as Mentor Graphics did back 20 years ago. And you start out and you have 4 error codes, and then you want to add a 5th and a 6th and a 7th. And then after a while, you just realize that the cost of adding an error code is too great, so you reuse one of the other ones, even though it's not right. And eventually you realize that all of the error codes are wrong, and you just have pass and fail, and that's it, and that's all you ever should have had in the beginning. So the whole thing is bogus, and it really matters. If you have to recompile your system every time you make a change, then you have a serious problem. So yes, it matters. Criteria for having pound includes in a header file. A header file must be self-sufficient with respect to compilation. We know this. That's why we include the component's header as the first substantive line in its CPP file. All right. There are 5 reasons commonly known for wanting to include a header in a header. What would they be? Why would I want to include a header in a header? I'll give you a hint. Izza. If I have circle, and circle is a shape, shape.h is being included in circle.h every time. In fact, you can depend on that. It's not even considered a transitive include. If you want shape to be in your file and you include circle, it's not a transitive include because circle has to include shape. It's not optional. Okay? Suppose I have an embedded data member, PASA. So if I have a point that has, or I say I have a box that has 2 points, I have no choice. I have to include point in the header file of box, right? Can you think of another one?
Return values to member functions.
Okay, so would that be uses in the interface?
Yeah.
Okay, not uses. So here I have point returned from append vertex. Thank you, by the way, I owe you for this. Notice I have const point ref here, and I've included point. I don't need to. I can do this. What may shock you is I'm returning point by value here. I don't need to. Why? Because unless I call this function in the client, no one cares how big point is. All right, inline functions. If I have an inline function, the body has to be compilable. So if I'm using something in the body of an inline function, then yes. And enum. It's a sort of a long story, but enum classes and the ability to forward declare enums is as bad as a local declaration of a function. And be wary. There be dragons there. Let me just leave it at that. So the old style enum, we couldn't forward declare it. So we have to put it in there. And then a type def, e.g. std string. We can't forward declare that, so if we want to use std string, we're going to need to pound include it. Turns out that there are some other corner cases like covariant return types. The nice thing is if you hit one of these corner cases which are not normal, the compiler will tell you and you'll deal with it. But all the rest of these are the five reasons. So if it's not one of these five reasons, don't do it. So we're going to cover what's called total insulation techniques.
A question for you.
Yes.
What about calling a template specialization from a template body, template function body?
A template specialization from a template body.
Using an implicit instantiation of a template.
I think you may be asking a question that I'll have to think harder on than I'm able to right now. But here's the deal. If your header file won't compile in isolation, then you must do it. If it will compile in isolation, then you shouldn't do it. How's that? And I'll leave it to you to figure out whether it's necessary. And if you find a hole in this that's in this area, this kind of edge area, well, we can talk about that. I'd be interested. Think about it and let me know after. All right, so total insulation techniques. So these are techniques that insulate you from every aspect of the implementation. And the first one is a protocol class or an abstract interface. So I have a client that has a service. If this is a concrete implementation, then if I make a change here, who knows what's going to happen. But if I make it abstract, then nothing but here is going to affect this, no matter what. So that is a very good way to completely decouple you, compile and link time. It's an awesome thing. This is architecturally significant, which means it's not a local change. What you're doing here affects your architecture, it affects your clients, it affects how they use your system. So we have to keep that in mind. Sometimes you can't do this. So here's another example where we have a widget. I have some common implementation here. Now, what can I do to fix this? I can take this and I can move the partial implementation up to here, leaving this pure. You can always do this. The only time you can't do this is when the client is somehow needing to access some inline function for performance, in which case you leave the minimal amount here that you have to. But in general, these are always pure abstract interfaces in any kind of wide API that you would use. Widely used API. All right. So discussion about that. That's the first total installation technique. Just use an abstract interface. Yep.
So Google has some strange feelings about abstract interfaces. There seems to be there's a lot of times where you only have one implementation of an interface potentially.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can break coupling by, you know, creating an abstract interface and then providing a single implementation of that interface. And that way, you know, you've broken your coupling. But now you have this extra complexity of having...
Right, and so the question is, or the statement is that Google has a strange view of breaking dependencies by adding an almost gratuitous indirection.
Yes.
And whenever you do that for testing purposes, when you say, for example, I instead of depending directly on the database, I want to depend on an abstract interface, and then I have an adapter that goes to the database. It allows you to swap out the database and put in a test implementation. If you're doing it for that reason, that's excellent, especially if the bandwidth across the thing is low, like going to a database. But if you're putting it in every which way, like between point and box and little things that are just that don't need it at all, and you're just doing it, then you're warping the architecture. So I would agree that should not be done too much. And again, you have to be a judge. If you're dealing with something at a very high level, an application level, and you need to do it for testing, you might need to do it. But I also don't add additional interface methods on a class for testing purposes. I refactor it into three pieces and test everything so that all I'm doing is just testing the pass-through from the chassis onto the implementation. Hope that answers that. Okay, anything else? Okay. Now, somebody asked me, where is he? Is he here? You. Knock, knock. You asked me about this. What do we mean by PIMPL? Pointer to implementation. Also spelled this way. So I have a concrete class, and the concrete class spans the .h and the .cpp file. And there's this other class that is used to hold the guts of this class completely, so that if I make a change to the guts, the client doesn't have to recompile. That is the only reason for using this. What's nice about it is it's not architecturally significant. What I have here is I have my class, and that's the member data, whatever it is, and then I have creators, and I have manipulators and accessors, and you'll notice I didn't have room for the const yet, and free operators. So that's my interface, and that's not going to change. Now, I add struct my class imp. So here's the CPP file. I have my class imp. Duplicate all member data and creators. That's the first thing I do. Then replace data with a single pointer to imp. So there you go. That's PIMPL. Then eliminate all inline functions. Then put the const back. Then what do we need to do next? So here, what I'm doing is I'm newing the implementation here. And in practice, we'd also provide an optional allocator in construction, because that's what we do. So then it would look like this. But we're not going to do that. So we won't do that. And then we need to simply use the data directly. Don't bother in the implementation rewriting all the methods to access the data. The data is already private in the CPP file. That would just be busy work, because you've got the data in the CPP file. You can change it. Nobody cares. When you destroy the class, you delete the imp. And just remember, access the data directly. Okay? So that's classic pointer to Impl Pimple. Any questions? All right. There's an extra indirection when you do this stuff. So it's expensive. You have to allocate and deallocate memory. It's a burden. If you're going to insulate something, insulate it early in the development process and then later relax it when things become stable. It is not architecturally significant. You can insulate these things on a case-by-case basis, one at a time. It is not like levelizing a design. You can do it incrementally. You can undo it incrementally. Okay. Don't ever expose the pointer. The pointer is not for anybody else's consumption. People actually do this, makes me crazy. Discussion.
Why would they do that?
They want to pass the, they think they have a multi-component wrapper, so they're gonna create a wrapper for the thing, and then they're gonna have the implementation, they're gonna pass the implementation to somebody else's implementation. It's completely nuts. It's like, what are you doing? What on earth? No, it's nuts. All right, so procedural interface. The procedural interface is designed to interface with C, typically. Oh, but in any event, it's a very sterile way of interfacing with an arbitrarily ugly system. So what I do is create all these functions, and I put them at a high level, and all of them are at the same level, none of them interact. They're all calling in here. This is my object-oriented subsystem. This is my procedural interface. And entirely independent of every other PI functions, physically separate from any C++ components, totally devoid of additional implementation beyond what's needed to accomplish the installation, named in a natural, regular, and predictable way, callable from both C and C++, and exposes the underlying types from the C++. Come on in. All right. So, here we have the procedural interface for a point. Well, this is the underlying point. We haven't gotten to it yet. So I'm going to ignore the include guards and all that good stuff. And this is the CPP file, but this is the interface, basically. And we always, of course, have the .cpp file. This is always the first thing that we include. We always put everything in our enterprise-wide namespace, and in this particular case, everything was inline, so that thing was empty. This is defined outside the package namespace to make sure that if we get the signature wrong or the return type wrong at compile time, that we get a compile time error. So that's an important deal. We always want to define our free functions outside of the namespace in which they're declared. Right. Okay, so now notice that we have this thing called Z underscore. And the Z is there to give us a one-to-one correspondence between the underlying thing and the procedural interface. That's what that Z is there for. So every one of these things here is the way in which we get at the underlying objects. There, I'll put that up for people to see. Now, if you look at point.h continued, you'll notice it's not particularly pretty, but it's interacting with C, and you know we have overloading, and we have all these good things in C++. So getting it to work with C requires some perseverance. Anyway, so now, if we're in C++, it looks like this. If we're in C, the structure is what it is. It's just the name of the struct. So I'm just putting this up there as an idea. Move that over there. So if we want to look at the correspondence, here's my point constructor, and here's how we create something. Here's the value constructor. I will call it a value constructor. I know I'm misusing the term, but this is how we construct a value from an X and a Y. This is our copy constructor. This is our destructor. Notice that we have to do everything by hand because it's a procedural interface. And it just keeps going on. And why do I use the F there? Because it reminds me that it's a procedural interface and it's purely style. But you get the idea, and this is what it looks like. It's so much easier in C++ than it is in C, but I don't know how else to do this. So this is what we do.
Can you default with this thread? I mean, if that possible?
Can I default?
Can you say, I'm not even sure it's possible. I know you could say point parens equals default now.
Oh, I can do a lot of things and just leave it out and it'll still get generated, but I don't do that. I always put in exactly what I want just because that's the way I grew up and I just do it. And I always wonder when people leave something out, did you mean to leave it out? Plus I document, this doesn't have documentation, I document every single member function thoroughly, so I want something to document. So I have the thing and then I document it underneath. Not on top, underneath. Anyway. But yes, you can default it. There are things. You could say equals default, equals delete. If I didn't want this, for example, I could say equals delete, and then it wouldn't be there. Okay. So then, if we look at this, the CPP file, now I'm just going to map the header to the CPP. Just a couple of examples. This is what it looks like. And I'll just show you a couple. I don't need to show you all of them. But that's what it looks like. Now you notice I used asserts here. We have something called BSLS assert that we use, and so they would actually all look like these macros. This is something that's under active consideration in the standards committee, and we've been using this for 50 years maybe, I don't know, close to 15 years, maybe 12 years, 13 years, and this works really well, but there's currently a discussion of how we can incorporate runtime precondition checks with annotating the interface of functions and somehow get something that's better than either one. I'm not sure about that, but we're working on it. So we'll see how that comes out, but hopefully by October, we'll have a unified paper that takes these, what are currently macros, and turns them into something that's part of the C++ 17 standard. So just pointing that out. Must ensure exceptions don't leak out into C code, so that's an important thing to remember. The BSLS assert allows you to do whatever you want if a precondition is violated, and it also allows you different levels of checking. So if you're not into checking a lot, you can spend a little bit of time, a lot of time, a whole lot of time, or no time at all. So this is clearly architecturally significant, right? We're calling things in a procedural way. So discussion about that. Yes. How do you do it?
Yeah.
Very carefully. I put it up there because it's too hard to even go into. You know, you have to try and catch and do all kinds of crazy things, or just make sure that nothing that you do throws exceptions. Yes?
So you said that, this is maybe a bit of an aside, but I'm just kind of curious. You said that you've always defined everything that you wanted, so presumably you always have a copy constructor.
If I want it. If I don't want it, I make clear that it's not there.
Okay, so I'm just curious, if you transition to C++ 11, then if you have them explicitly, if you have them defined, then you don't get the automatic generation of the move constructor. Have you found that to be...
Oh, because if you say equals defined, then it suppresses things?
Yeah, so if you provide...
It hasn't bit us yet, because we haven't gotten there yet. When we get there, we'll have to look at it. I'm not sure whether we would extend the notion into saying we'll define all of them anyway, or whether we'll leave them all out. Because generally when we have classes, well often when we have classes, they're non-trivial. They do something. Then there are things like attribute classes that are absolutely not, that are exactly trivial. For those, we might make an exception. Seems like a reasonable thing. Yes?
You do get the nice behavior if all of your definitions are equals delete or equals default.
You do? So I don't know if that's true. I heard that equals default actually has an effect. Do you know?
I do not know.
Does anybody know if equals default?
I'm not certain.
I heard recently that equals default actually suppresses something.
Default your move constructor as well.
Yeah, I think so. I think that's true.
Okay.
You can default a copy constructor, you just default the move constructor.
Yeah, it seems weird that that's the case.
It's strange. It's a little stranger. What you said makes sense, but that doesn't mean that's what we did. Okay. All right. So now, partial insulation is actually very important because sometimes you can't afford total insulation and still because of performance, and still you can get a lot of mileage out of partial insulation. So here's our date util. And here we're just going to show an example of how we can get a little bit of insulation here with our data. So here I have static int data, and I want to get the I thing out of the array of data that I have. And here I want to know the length of the data that I have. But there's nothing in here that tells the client what the data is or how long it is. So if I change my mind, no one has to recompile, assuming that that works. So here's an example of the implementation file, and here's the data, and here's how I've hooked up the static method in the class to the data, and here's how I've hooked up the length to the data. Very evil, right? But now, if I want to change things like this, no one has to recompile, just relink. So you see, this is a completely different thing. There's always a physical dependency, but now I don't have to recompile when I make a change. Does this make sense? Okay. Discussion about that? All right. So now I have this toy stack, and literally it's a stack of toys. So there you go. Stack constructor. In this case, just sets everything to zero, and I want to push a toy, says, well, if the length is equal to the capacity, I'm going to have to resize. Otherwise, I'm just going to put my toy on the appropriate place and then increase the stack pointer. Very straightforward. Classic example for introductory C++, right? But this is in the implementation. And therefore, there's function call overhead. And this operation should happen very quickly, right? So what are we going to do? First thing we want to do is we want to move it to the header file. I don't happen to ever put my bodies inside functions. I always put them at the bottom and say inline and all that good stuff. But for the purposes of this, we'll do that. Now, the problem here is that there's a lot of extra work going on or could be a lot of extra work going on if I actually did the resize here. But notice that I have a function called resize. And what that does is it says, in the unlikely event that I need to resize, that's also a very expensive operation. I will go do that. So if the length equals the capacity, not, then I'll just do what I need to do and I'm done. It's very quick. But if the length does equal the capacity, then I'm going to call resize, and then resize is going to go make sure I have enough space over in the CPP file where there's a lot of crap going on. I'm including, you know, who knows what extra header files and anything else that I don't want to make my client see. So I've insulated my client from that. Moreover, I've got a lot of detail here that might change over time. So let's see what might happen here. Like this right here, I said if the capacity is zero, make it one, otherwise double the capacity. Well, what if I decide I want to change it to 1.5? I could do that. I don't want my clients to recompile. Or maybe I want to do something like this. Maybe that's better. So the nice thing here is I can make changes to the implementation, and most of the time I'm inlining it. And when I'm not inlining it, I'm calling a private member function to take me to the CPP file where my client can't see all the stuff that I'm changing and including and whatever. So that is a very nice partial insulation approach. Have people seen this before? It is a tutorial I'm doing. Oh, right. Okay. So maybe some of you have seen that. Let's talk about a multi-pool allocator, or the basis for one, and how you might implement such a beast. So what is a multipool? It allocates some number of bytes and deallocates. It's the basis for a general purpose allocator. So what I have here, let's see. Yeah, let me back up a second. So what this is doing is it basically saying I have this allocator and I have these different pools, and they're adaptive pools. And depending on what size I request, I will be pulling from a particular bin. And I'll start out with giving you one, And then if you ask for another, I'll get two and give you one, and then the other, and so on and so forth. So let me just go past this. So for example, if I ask for something that's between 17 and 24, it'll go to that. If I ask for something that's 1,020, or between 1016 and 17 and 1024, it'll go up there. If it's too big, it'll just pass through and go to the underlying allocator, and that's the oversized stuff. And in this particular case, we're looking at data of size 49 to 56, which seems to be very common. So you can see that it saturates, say, at 32. Once I allocate 32 things, that's enough that allocating 64, it doesn't really matter. It's already been amortized over 32 allocations. And this is all experimental. And it might be different depending on particular machines and implementations. But 20 years ago, I wrote this kind of thing and learned that having it allocate 32 right off the bat was a big mistake. Because if you allocate 32 right off the bat, and then somebody creates a vector of maps, like a vector of a million maps that have one thing in it, the whole thing, it's just horrible. So don't do that. You've got to guard against both a lot of very small things and one very large thing. And this seems to address that issue very nicely.
Can I have a quick question?
You can.
Does it, when you allocate a pool, let's say, of 16, does it check if there are already three elements in a pool of...
All right, so wait, hold on a second. This is a multipool. We need to dig down to see what a pool is. This is a multipool. So we're gonna go look at what just a pool is. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's do that. We're gonna look at just this. So give me a moment.
Okay.
So here's a pool of 56, and here's some data members in the pool. I think you can, looking at this, you'll see that that your question is answered, which was, do we have a free list? Because at the bottom, you'll notice there's this free list. So what happens? Let's walk through it. I have a block list, and the block list maintains an arbitrary list of allocated large blocks. So, and by the way, this is not optimized. If I optimize this, it could be half the size. I don't want to do that. So I'm leaving it big so I can explain it. It's simplified, in other words. Here's my block list. Here, I've said that my block size is 56. So each one of those things represents a block of 56. 56 bytes, okay? Here's the chunk size, 32, and that's how much I'm currently allocating at a time, right? Here's the begin, that's where the next available piece is. Here's the end, it's one past the end of the sequence of available blocks. And here is the free list, and this is what's been put back since I last allocated a new chunk. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's what an adaptive pool looks like in a multipool. And then multipool allocators also have to worry about how you keep the pool size along with the data. So there's a little bit more to it than that.
Yeah.
Okay, good or?
I'm not sure it answers my...
Okay, what was your question?
So if at one point I want to allocate a block of 16, would it make sense to... If I see that I have a free block of a multiple of 16, to allocate the...
Okay, so the question is, do you try to do coalescing and partitioning in a multipool allocator? Never. Because the whole point of a multipool allocator is to avoid that kind of overhead.
No, it's not that my question.
Okay, so say it again.
So if I want to allocate a block of 16, and I see that I don't have a pool of 16s yet, but I have a pool of a multiple of 16, like
32.
124, and I have a free block in that pool of 124, would it make sense to, instead of mallocing my pool of 16, to place my pool of 16 inside one?
Okay, so the question is, do we reuse other pools when we don't have something in this pool? No, we don't, ever. Because the overhead of doing that kills the whole purpose of the quick allocation and deallocation of a multipool allocator. So no, we don't.
Okay.
Absolutely never. But besides, the pools here are there's one type. There's something called a memory pool, which is dynamic. And when you add, you create it with a given size, and then you ask it for something. And if it doesn't have it, it gets it for you. So there's no way for the multipool to even go in there and ask the question. It's like, give it to me. So, no. Anyway, so back to this. So I have this pool, and just to see what happens when it's empty, these are all empty lists. It's created with a size of 56. It's got an arbitrary sentinel value that for implementation reasons might be 0, might be 1. We'll see later. But we'll have to think about that. Then if we allocate, what happens is the block list creates a block. This is for one pool, and it returns the data. So there you go, that's after that happens. Then I allocate again, that's what happens. You get some more data. Then if I deallocate, it puts it back on the free list. If I then allocate, it gives me the next one, because that's the order in which things are produced. Then, if I ask for another one, it that's empty, so it goes and checks the free list, and it says, yes, I'll give you back that one. And then if you allocate again, then it goes and gives you another piece. So this is how the multipool, or this is how the pool, the adaptive pool, builds itself up. And then over time, it looks like this. Does that make sense? This is what we have at Bloomberg. This is what we did our benchmarks on. If anybody wants to check out 4468, we did a whole wonderful allocator test that even has a mascot that's a duck. His name is Divluck. It's a very nice, colorful paper, and 4468. But we showed how this particular allocator can save you a lot of time over a long-running program that has regions that are visited and then left and on to the next and so on and so forth.
Stack order.
Stack order.
Yeah, like can I deallocate a block in the middle somewhere there?
No. All right, so let me clarify this. This is going to go in order until it gets to the end here.
Yes.
Then, if you ask for another, it's going to check the free list.
Sure.
And then when the free list is empty, it's going to allocate another block and reposition at the beginning. And these, once this is used up, this is done, and it's never going to go back here. It's always going to go to the free list. And when you get rid of this, when you're all done, the block list is going to delete the top blocks without ever looking at any details at all. So these will never be looked at. These will never be looked at. It is just those blocks. There'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 deallocations. And if you've chained together another allocator, you can even skip that, and just it could all be on the program stack, and it could just go away without any instructions. But that's a little beyond the scope of this. But you can do some crazy stuff. I suggest you read the paper. It's quite comprehensive. There's a lot of data. As I said, there's a duck in there. All right.
I'm looking at it.
Okay. You're looking. Check out the duck. It's cool.
Yeah.
And it's in color. All right. So, anyway.
A duck has nice
pictures. I know it has nice pictures. It has three-dimensional surfaces, too.
Does it quack?
It definitely quacks. Now, quiet. I'm going to get through this. I need a drink. All right. All right, pool.h and pool.h continued. All right, where am I now? I'm trying to remember where I am. So this is just initializing the pool. We chose this. It's special. I just want to get past this. Now, if I want to deallocate something, this is inline. And we're going to look at that more. So link the block onto the front of the free list. So that's what's going to happen here. So if I say deallocate, this is going to say, yeah, it's just going to link onto the front of the free list. That's all it does. It doesn't. There's nothing else to do, so that's very simple. But allocating is a little bit more complex. So here's our pool.allocate. This is inline. And it says, is there a block available in the current chunk? So we've got all this code here to figure that out. And if there isn't, check the free list. Else, get a block. Get block from new chunk. So this is still all inline. This is the expensive one. We're saying that these are relatively cheap, and we want them to happen quickly. We're saying if we have to go get a new block, then we want to put it there in the CPP file. So that's get block from new chunk. So we'll move that over. That took some time to make work. And then when we say get block from chunk, it puts it over to here. And now you can see that there are a number of interesting constants that we might want to tweak in the pool. And so maybe the chunk size shouldn't be 32. Maybe it should be 64. Maybe what happens here, instead of having the chunk size start at 1, maybe as soon as we realize that that the thing is no longer empty, we're going to skip over 1, 2, 4, and go to 8. And I think I've seen that in Struestrup's new book, that's the way the vector is implemented. If you have an empty vector and you start to allocate memory, it skips over 1, 2, and 4 and goes straight to 8. At least that's what I saw. And I saw that a year after I wrote this, so that's kind of interesting. I just made this up. I had no idea. So the point is here, more speed efficient. We could make it more space efficient. If we wanted to, we could put some stuff down here. We can change all of this stuff without having to make our clients recompile, which means it's really good for performance tuning. Because if you have to make the entire world recompile in order to try a new thing here, you won't try as many, right? Okay. So another possibility, I'm going to revise this, which is suppose I want to make the inline function as small as possible. So I want to save code bloat. Here I'm saying if I can pull it off the thing quickly, do it. Otherwise, everything else is in the CPP file. And this is another reason to do partial insulation. Excuse me. Okay. So here you can see this is the part that says if it's on the free list, get it. If not, do what we did before. My bronchitis is acting up. Okay. Discussion of adaptive memory pools.
Are these shared between different objects?
Okay, so if you have an allocator and you create a vector or a list or a map with that allocator, and then you create another map or list with the same allocator, then yes. Thread safety is a separate issue. You can have a multiple allocator that either does sequencing or not. They're two different allocators. If you don't need it, don't use it, right? Because that's overhead you don't need. And one of the nice things about having local allocators is you can avoid contention. By the way, the name of the duck is divluck, and divluck stands for density, variation, locality, utilization, and contention. That's why we have a duck. So you can remember the five dimensions of when it's appropriate to use an allocator. Okay, questions?
It's kind of an open-ended question. You probably answered it, but you say that this allocator, if you have an application that runs for like a month or 2 months, and you see that it's...
You must read the paper. If you have an application that runs for 2 months, you will get memory diffusion, and you must read the paper and see how you can take advantage of local allocators. You must. Okay. You just must.
Thank you.
Okay.
Can you listen to the number of the paper again?
4468. Yep.
What's the purpose of the growth factor? Why don't you just start out with 32?
Okay, so the question was, why do I have a growth factor? As I said, when I was at Bear Stearns many years ago, I created a map. And the first time anybody put anything in the map, it created 32 right off the bat. Actually created 100. And then somebody created a vector of a million maps with one thing in each. And it blew up. So that's why. So it has to grow. But you might choose not to go from 0, 1, 2, 4, 8. You might choose to go from 1 to 8. But you wouldn't go from 1 to 32. And I question whether 1 to 8 is worthwhile, because what is 1, 2, 3 allocations before you're up to something that's, you know, that's tuning. But just going right to 32 is probably not robust, because somebody will find a way to, you know, mess with you. Now, if you do it in an insulated way, you can address it, and that's what I add. Fortunately, I could drop in a dot O in front of the library, and it all just worked. And it was an insulated change. Had I not had that, I would have been in deep doo-doo, because the whole trading system, okay, is important. Okay. Here's some questions. Why don't we answer this one? Why, when would you put a pound include directive in a dot H? What are they?
Not that I remember them. Iza,
Haza, inline, enum, and typedef to template, and then some spurious ones. Okay? What?
So that I can tell you what it's not.
Okay. Thank you. All right.
Answer to the template question, by the way, is probably you don't have to include it, but you would get weird error messages.
Well, if you get weird error messages, that might be good enough. So if there's something about your header file that needs on its own for you to have included some other header file, then do it.
Sorry, gets weird error messages when somebody else causes instantiation.
Well, that's a different story. If somebody else is calling your stuff, they have to include it. Very good. Okay. All right. Which total insulation technique is not architectural?
Pimple.
Pimple. Excellent. Why would one choose partial over total insulation?
Performance.
Performance. Excellent. There we go. All right. Okay. So we have some organizing principles. This is a facet, a very important one. But sound physical design is the biggest one by far. If you don't have this, you don't have anything. So if you start off and you're a good person, you'll factor your application and your reusable stuff from day one when you go to a company. And somebody else will come along and use your stuff and thank you. And then somebody else will come along and realize that they don't need this, but other people might, and so you'll factor that out as well. We're off to a good start. But unfortunately, not everybody plays by the rules. You get an application that comes along, tries to depend on you. Not so good, right? What's wrong with this? These people are out to make money for themselves. These people, they're not out to help these people. If they make a change to their application, those people could be in deep doo-doo. So you want to make sure that you depend on stable libraries, not on malleable applications. So what's wrong with this up arrow? After all the levelization stuff we've talked about, is this a problem yet? It's not a problem yet, but there's something wrong when a dependency arrow goes up. You know there's a problem. That's a real problem. That's a cycle. Now, if we keep going, that's a big cycle. At this point, we're pretty much done, because over time, you'll see that it'll look.
How much time did it take you to make that slide?
There are slides that take a lot longer than this. I used hierarchy. All right, so this is important. The idea, when you're designing stuff, it's not an afterthought. And in fact, when you go to pull something apart in the problem analysis stage, if you pull it apart like this, you're going to wind up with cycles, most likely. If you pull it apart like this or like this, you'll wind up with subproblems that, when they're solved and recombined, give you acyclic architectures. Okay, So let's take a look at some things that happen in real life. So we start out with this logger. We're very happy with it. It's nicely factored. I've got lots of components down here that are reusable. And then I've got my logger. And then we decide we need transport. So we know transport is flaky, so we're going to want to use the logger. And in fact, we can't use any kind of fancy callbacks or anything like that, because logging is something that has to be compiled in. It's very tightly coupled. It has to run very quickly when it's not being used. So we have to do this. Then we say, I want to write a mail system. Of course, we can use our new transport. All good so far. And then one fine day, the head of the company says, you know, that transport system is really flaky. The next time there's a bug, I want you to send mail to me. And so that happens. And we have to resist this temptation. What would we do to fix this? What is the obvious answer? It's very easy.
Split mail into a low level.
Okay, almost. What we're going to do is the logger is going to have an observatory where anybody can register a callback called an observer. Then it looks like this. With that adapter is just one of many observers. This particular one knows about the mail system. Okay? Anything can be solved with a little thought. All right. Don't do this. This is a true story. When I was at Bear Stearns, they actually called a consulting company over, whose name I won't repeat, and suggested for the price of many millions of dollars that they build a layered system. And literally everything depended on the database, direct static dependency. And what's wrong with this? Well, when you start writing things like this, and it depends directly on the database, you wind up with everything depending directly on the database. You can't do anything without the database. So if the database goes down, you take a vacation. Suppose you designed it like this. Now, I can work on my business logic and my business objects, which are really value types, don't tell anybody. And these are really algorithms, don't tell anybody. And these are really mechanisms that load the business objects from the database. And this could all be in C. But if we went to C++, we could do things like have an abstract interface so that we could have a test persister and a particular Oracle persister, perhaps even other database, and we get some more flexibility. This is called a lateral design, not a layered design. It's much more flexible. And I think you can appreciate that I can use all of this stuff on my laptop on the train home. I don't have to be tied to the database. Okay. So the last thing I want to talk to you about, and I do mean that, is suppose your boss says, write me a date class that tells me whether today is a business day. How do you feel about that?
Impossible.
What?
Impossible.
Impossible. Not good, eh? So you got to say something. So you look at it and you go, not good. You don't want a date class that looks like what we saw before that depends on everything in the kitchen sink. Because what is a date class supposed to do? Represent a date value. That's it. So I could say some things, but my voice is going, so I'll let the slides speak for themselves. What are the real requirements? What do you think the boss wanted when the boss said this?
A function?
Okay. What else?
He wanted to know whether a date was a business thing.
Okay. Well, that probably wanted something like that. But do you think in the mix of things that the boss wanted, maybe represent a date value as a C++ type was in there? Don't you think that might have been on the back of his or her mind? Maybe. How about this? Determine what date value today is. How about determine if a date value is a business day? Separation of concerns. How about we provide all of this stuff and more while we're going about answering that silly question? So let's start. We'll start with this. And now I want to add color to the equation. We've seen dependencies. So we're now going to treat different class categories with different colors. Now, we know value types are really cool, so they're going to be blue. Now, mechanisms are value types that don't try to represent a value, which I know you don't like. So mechanisms do something, but they don't try to represent a value, like a thread pool. They're green, obviously. Protocols are not concrete. We're going to make them yellow. Then utilities are going to be pink, and meta functions are hot, don't touch, they're red. Okay? So with that, this is a mechanism. Bytestream, we remember Bytestream. It's a mechanism. What color is it?
Green.
Okay. Day of week is an enum. What kind of type do you think an enum is? Yes. An enumeration is a value type. What color is it? Blue. That's a really pitiful blue. It's blue on my screen. Crap. That just kills me. All right. Date is a complex constraint value semantic type. It is also blue. This really is not good. They're blue. Damn it. All right. Well, anyway, that's the solution to the first question. The second one is determine what date value today is. And it turns out that we need a lot more stuff. This is a high precision time type. A daytime interval is the difference between two datetimes, and a datetime is a time and a date. And a system time util is where we go to load up the datetime to get the date that we wanted to know. So, utility, what color? Please, oh. All right, this thing really is bad. I'm sorry, that is pink. Unconstrained value semantic type, this is killing me, that's blue. This is just so lame. Blue.
Green, that would be
invisible. We're, those are blue. Oh, I really, all right. So this is how we would put together those things, because these are all independently useful pieces. Determine if a date value is a business day. Okay, put it over there. Now, what is this? It's an abstract base class. It is the quintessential abstract base class. It is a polymorphic memory resource scheduled for 2017. It's a protocol, so it's yellow. Good, at least we can see that. Day of week set. What is the day of week set? It describes the possible weekend days for a particular locale in a calendar. So how big is this object? How big? If I say size of day of week set, how big is it?
In China, it's zero.
A byte. This is one byte. It needs 7 bits. So even though it has a big name, it's a little object. Don't give it an allocator. Okay, it's blue. Damn. A packed calendar and a calendar represent the same ethereal type, which is a set of business days over a date range, plus weekend days, plus holidays, plus some other things. So these are actually representing the same value. They're the same, they're approximately the same ethereal platonic value type. So that's a value semantic type, it's blue, and the calendar is also blue, even though it doesn't look very blue. And I would say we're done, but there's a problem. What's the problem? Where's the data? Where's the data that tells us whether today is a date is a business day?
Is it back in your database?
It's back in my database. So we need a calendar cache, and a calendar cache doesn't try to represent a platonic type because it depends on this calendar loader, which is I'm going to call that a mechanism because it is. So it's green. The calendar loader is an abstract interface, so it's yellow. And then we'll go over to the application domain that knows about the weekends and holidays, and this mechanism implements this, so it's green. Then we come back over, and now we know, now we're done with this. But the fourth one is, we realized along the way that there were a couple of other things that we'd like to have, but we just weren't asked for it. So for example, if I want to know what the fourth Thursday is in November 2015, well, that's a function. That's a utility on a date. Don't need a calendar for that. So I'm going to put it here. It's going to depend on the day of week set, because I also might want to know how many Mondays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays there are in a month, because I happen to have my housekeeper come on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, and I have to pay her each month, so that might be a good function. So I have it depend on date util. And then that's pink, by the way. I know it's hard to tell, but that is a util, and it's pink. And then there are certain kinds of algorithms like modified following that are designed to tell you whether a given day is a business day, and if it's not, give me the next business day in the month, or if there isn't one above this day, give me the highest business day in the month that is a business day. I mean, the highest day in the month that is a business day. And so that will depend on calendar. We don't want to put that here, so we'll put it up there, and it will depend on date and calendar, and any kind of function that needs calendars would go up there. So now we have a nice, easy way to find things. Fine-grained class design. So remember, we have logical and physical. We're going to go to the physical view of this. This is the component view now. We were doing classes, but really they're components. And there's really a nice mapping between the two. And that's the BDE package group and the BDET package. And all of these fun things that talk about time live in BDET. And they will be open sourced in BDLT very soon.
Is today in there?
Is today.
Where is today? Where is right now?
Oh, that is a utility. That's a utility that tells you that finds out what today is and returns it as a date time. So that's something higher. That's a higher level utility. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's part of this whole design. And then BSL is the low-level overlay of the containers, and BSLS is the lowest-level function. So BSL is open-sourced right now, and BSLS is the very lowest package in our whole physical hierarchy. So now if we look at this, these are client-facing. We want to add some non-client-facing factoring. So the date is implemented in terms of something else. That's that cache thing that we talked about. And all of them use BSLS assert, because all of these things have narrow contracts, and therefore we want to be able to check that the preconditions were satisfied where that makes sense. Virtually every library component uses BSLS assert. So now I'm going to show you what a transitive reduction is. These are all direct dependencies. If I take out this arc, it doesn't change the level numbers. The level numbers remain, and this makes the picture a little bit more readable. So now, let's take a look at this. This is the calendar and the pack calendar, which are visible to clients. Suppose I want to fill in the pieces that you don't see that are still useful for other things, like a packed interarray. That's needed for the packed calendar. And the packed calendar is space efficient and the calendar is speed efficient. That's why we have the two. And the calendar is necessary for the modified following algorithms, because it's very, very fast at telling you whether a day is a business day. So BSMLA default is what we need whenever we have memory allocation in case you don't supply an allocator. That's where it gets it from. And the default allocator is the new delete allocator, so we need that. And of course, that is a allocator, so we need that. So that's that side. The default here uses BSLS assert. None of those two need it. Then the bit array is what makes the calendar fast, because it can just jump to the bit and answer the question. But the bit array needs the default because it allocates memory. It's implemented in terms of a bit string util. This is multi-word utilities. This is implemented in terms of a single word utility, so that's factored, and in turn, This has narrow contracts, so it depends on BSLS assert. So now you get the idea of what goes on behind the scenes. We did the top level design, then we came back and did the other side. We factored things out until they got to their natural minimal buildable size. There's nothing left to factor. And that's what it looks like.
In color.
But no red.
How did that happen?
That was rather a complicated question.
Wow. Anyway, this is an approximation to the truth because this is about as much as I could keep in my head. So I had to get some tools. And this is closer to the truth. Notice there's some meta functions lurking. And actually, this isn't even the truth. The real truth is this. This is everything that we needed in our system to implement. Tell me whether today is a business day class is a business day thing. But the nice thing is we already had this because we designed our system all along for years and years and years with this in mind. So writing this was actually very easy. And in fact, this particular design existed 10 years ago, and we're 10 years ahead of where we were then. So this is our stack. We have BSL, which is the basic standard library, and BDE, which is a recursive acronym for BDE development environment. And then it's BDE business environment, concurrency environment, application environment, and transport environment. And do we have any questions? Well, that was what I wanted to tell you. Give you one more chance to ask questions, or I'm going to let you go.
How much attention do you spend on cache friendliness in your design?
Cache friendliness. We measure what we do very carefully, and the allocators are an example of that. I think the answer to that question has to be for any particular application, we have to measure it and tune it and observe it. And there are obviously times when you can do really dumb things, like the fault sharing and such, that are bad. And so we pay attention to that. But I don't know if any of us are necessarily the world's best threading experts. But we do measure it. I mean, The application groups that worry about multi-threading and worry about the low latency and high performance have much more knowledge about how to detect that. And if there's a problem with us, they would tell us if there was something that was wrong. But I don't see that really applies to the thing that we did for this particular design, the one about the dates and the calendars and all that. I don't think it actually shows up much. I don't think. But, you know, anyway. Anything else? Well, you guys have been great. Quick review, and then I'm going to quit. First thing is a component is a fundamental unit of both logical and physical design. No cyclic dependencies, no long-distance friendships. Collocate logical constructs only with good reason. Friendship, cycles, part of a whole, flee on an elephant. And lastly, include in a header only with good reason. Is a has a inline enum, type def to template, and that's it. Thank you.